Join us this week as we sail to the rugged west coast of Tasmania.
Sailing downwind, motoring into the wind. Now we're reaching with a tiny bit of head sail. It's so windy out there that we can actually see little water spouts on the surface.
So we've turned tide and run. We're finding a tide.
Well, in usual free range style, the itinerary has been interrupted to go forage for food.
I'm sort of looking forward to just a nice relaxing day of sailing.
Not the case.
It's been technical.
Welcome to Free Range Sailing. Join us as we sail around Australia, visiting its wild places in our 30-foot, 50-year-old sailing boat, Maroul.
Living off the land and sea while sailing a yacht that costs less than a new car, we show that it's possible to have big adventures with a seaworthy boat on a very modest budget.
With plans to sail down the Derwent River and into the channel between Bruny Island and the mainland of Tasmania, we waved goodbye to Hobart with a rag of head sail.
The Derwent's giving us a bit of a send-off with fluky winds coming from behind, different directions. I guess it's getting spun off the mountains and things around us. Keeping you cool.
I think we'll just get away from that land.
Yeah.
We're just heading just straight out in the middle of the river.
Yeah.
We'll just see how that works out for us.
Yeah.
Because things are too crazy at the moment. We're having wind shifts of like 30 degrees one way, 30 degrees the other. Like it's almost 60 degrees of shift and then back again.
Yeah.
Like I've altered course 20 degrees off. And the wind is straight behind us again.
So what are we doing? We're doing 5 knots?
We were doing 5.5, 6.
The wind just eased.
Things are chilled out a little bit.
Things are very fluky, but we have a reefed head sail and we're just taking it casual.
At the moment we've got a full head sail, I just eased it all out.
Oh, did you? I can't see under the dodger.
No, we did have the head sail for opacity, but I've eased it all out now. We're just staying on a steady tack. So, you know, the wind wouldn't catch us by surprise. I wouldn't have to jibe, be overwhelmed. So we're just taking a little bit cautiously because one of our key strategies for keeping costs down on the boat is try not to break the boat too much. And so we're very conservative in the way we sail. We don't really race and we don't bring out every knot that we possibly can when the winds are strong. That's for certain. Oh, look at that, we're going, getting up that 5.5 knots again.
We just had another big gust. The autopilot's doing its thing and Troy's just reefed the head sail a bit more. We've gone from motoring into the wind to, yeah, you know.
We've gone from sailing downwind to motoring.
Sailing downwind, motoring into the wind, now reaching with a tiny bit of head sail.
As we sailed south towards the channel entrance, the wind had bent round from the northwest and was blowing straight into us at least 30 knots from the south.
Now this is 25 kilometres an hour wind from the northwest apparently. So we've turned tail and run, we're fighting a tide. Going into the teeth of the wind. And a pretty sloppy sea going into the Dentricasto Channel. So I decided to turn tail and we'll just go on the eastern side of the island, just anchor up for the night. See how things look tomorrow morning. So they don't look that great at the moment.
Just a wind gust.
We're going straight downwind at the moment. I need to turn this corner, but I don't want to hit the reef.
See little water spouts on the surface. Well, well done for getting us here.
Oh man.
It's not where we planned to be.
That was some tough going, but at least we had the option of turning around, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So if we had that option, that's what we pursued. So we've come around onto the eastern side and we'll sit it out and we'll try again tomorrow.
Yeah.
But yeah. It's no damage to the boat.
Right.
That's our main rule, isn't it? Don't break the boat. Well, actually, our main rule is don't fall off the boat.
Set fire to the boat. But don't break the boat. It's like, don't set fire to the boat.
Don't fall off the boat's rule number one. Don't set fire to the boat. And don't hit anything with the boat or break the boat.
Yeah.
I don't think we have any more rules after that. You're supposed to eat cheese regularly.
Early morning the next day, conditions were favourable for us to pass through the channel. Never miss an episode of Free Range Sailing again. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell button to stay notified of all our upcoming releases.
Oh, so we lost the wind again. This has been a feature of coming up the Dentricasto Channel. We're on our way to explore a bay in the southern end of Bruny Island, southernish end of Bruny Island, called Quarries Bay.
There's a boat that's got wind over there, and it's the same. Like, we had wind roaring in into here while another guy was motoring back there.
Crazy shenanigans.
We're out in the middle, so we sort of, oh, there goes the sail. You'd sort of think we would get some wind here, but...
Tacking?
No, not tacking. But there's a catamaran just there. And I just wanted to be courteous and get out of his way before we came back on our line. Sheet winches are getting a lot more use than that fishing rod is. We're just I'm just waiting for one of these waves to climb up my back.
Oh.
So far Maroola's been pretty dry in this though.
What were your impressions of the channel? Too cray?
I was sort of looking forward to just a nice, relaxing day of sailing.
Not the case.
It's been technical. The wind certainly doesn't come from a consistent direction, but this has probably been the steadiest wind we've had all day. And this is the time it really boosts as well. Across the channel now, we tucked in. Where did we tuck in?
The quarries.
We went to Quarry Bay, but I actually had a bit of an upset tummy, so we didn't actually do anything there. We were pretty boring. We made some videos and we did some work.
Mm.
Obviously, we didn't film that. So now we're just crossing the D'Entrecasteaux channel.
Nice.
And we're heading into Dover for a quick look around just before we head round to the west coast, you know, our last little brush with civilization. We're just passing these fish farms here at the moment, they breed salmon, and I don't really want to comment on it because I haven't been here long enough and I haven't had a look at it, but obviously they're, you know, quite controversial. I don't think anyone can dispute that they artificially increase the amount of nutrients, you know, in the water here by wasted fish food and then also the manure coming off the salmon that they're fattening up. But it's surprising how big an operation it actually is. Like just one of these pens, if you have a look, you know, that's a lot of boat. It's quite an investment in the region. We've heard that they do want to move them further out into deeper water. So that, you know, public opinion, some is for. Obviously, people will normally argue in their best interest. But then there's also some people that want to maintain Tasmania. Well, not maintain it, but actually get it back to a pristine state, because part of Tasmania's history is actually a fair bit of primary industry has caused quite a bit of environmental damage here, and I think a lot of people would like to reverse that, and they don't want that to continue, and I can really see their point. We try not to let our personal views come across too much, you know, we just say what we see. But, you know, I think that would be a really great thing, but they're impressive. But if you didn't do your night navigation properly and you ran into one of those things, you would be in so much trouble.
Well, it's a rare, beautifully still, sunny day in Tasmania. Who would have thought? And we're going to go for a little bit of an exploration of Dover before we head out into the wilds of the west coast of Tasmania. I've written a little itinerary. We're going to go check out...
An itinerary?
Yeah. We're going to go, because different places open and shut. It's a very rural little country town, so places open and shut. So they're only open for a few hours at a time. So we're going to go to the distillery. They make a special type of spirit out of sassafras, so we'll check that out. And then we're going to go to a little vineyard on the hill, and then we're going to go stock up on some eggs and maybe some other local produce if we can, and have a look and see what little restaurants and bars there are in town. Probably not very many, but we'll see what there is. Well, in usual free-range style, the itinerary has been interrupted to go forage for food. We have found some mussels on the jetty. So we might have to put the distillery on hold until later this afternoon.
Oh.
that's not too bad. You just pull them off and then put the rest in the water.
If that's not a reason to buy in a town, I don't know what is.
Well, that vineyard doesn't look like it's been in action for a little while. So we're going to try our luck at the distillery. On Google it said it was still open and doing tastings, but...
Oh my god, Google lied to us.
Google lied. At least there's blackberries on the walk back. Feed of blackberries. Oh, yum.
After finding the distillery, we met the distiller Martin, who invited us in for a tasting of his spirit of oak. Of oak is a white spirit infused with leaves from the sassafras tree, which is native to the Tasmanian rainforest.
Yeah. So that's the leaf. So the leaf, now the reason I've been using it is I used to brew beer and just for myself, reading some of the early accounts of the colonialists first to arrive on the shores out here. They didn't have any hops, didn't bring any hops with them the first few fleets, yeah. So they needed to make an ale. They needed something for a bitter taste to impart for their ales. And they found when they were cutting all these trees, clearing all the land, if they boiled up the bark from the trees they were cutting down of sassafras, they got this bitterness out, which they used in the first ales made in Australia by white people. And being a bushwalker from, you know, a young lad, always fascinated me the aroma when you get, especially in summertime, you go bush, and it's drying out a little bit, and as soon as you crack a little leaf like that under your foot or whatever, or even just enter an area where there's a, you know, a group of these trees, and you can just immediately smell it, and it was just always refreshing. So back about 60 years ago, the Americans had some sort of battle going on and could prove that rats fed copious amounts of sassafras or their sarsaparilla, which is the same family they used to make root beer out of in America, that it had, it was considered to be a mild carcinogen. I had to overcome that thing because everyone said, oh, you can't do that. Oh, no, you know, you're dealing with a poison, you know. So I thought, we used to drink the bloody stuff. We used to chew the leaves. We all survived. I don't know anyone that died from it. So I just persisted for about 3 years until I got something I thought was reasonable. Then I sent it away to get tested for safrole. And even at three times the strength that I'm putting into what I'm putting in a bottle nowadays, there was no detectable safrole.
Oh.
So
all the flavour and none of the...
Not all of the flavour. But enough of the flavour. So how I did it, I'm not a chemist. I stumbled across it, basically. All right. So, and a few drops of water will actually open up the botanicals a little bit more.
It tastes a bit like gin.
I have a lot of people buy it. They just use it, they make their G&Ts with it. I just want tonic again. It's another one of those flavours you're adding to, and it, quite often the cheaper ones are sweet too.
That's
true. It's really, you know, it's hard to match a good tonic to a subtle flavoured spirit.
Yeah, you wouldn't taste the, it if you put tonic water in there.
I think if you put that in on ice.
We're generally straight spirit people.
Even
no ice, like you say. Just a bit
of water.
Martin also invited us for a look inside his distillery room.
Yeah, so it's very old design, possibly Chinese heritage. And then the Moors used it for many thousands of years, and it slowly made its way across to the Iberian Peninsula, where they still make them and still use them to make their calvados in Portugal and Spain.
Nice. Your dad will be interested. I love calvados.
So, and is it? Everything you see there, all part of it? Like, is this...
Are they old stills?
They're the ones I started with.
Yeah.
Which I was able to import as ornaments.
Oh, nice.
And we never have them for ornaments, less than 4 litres, 5 litres.
Yeah.
But you're not allowed to use them.
What you doing?
I just put a new SIM card into our Iridium Go sat phone because we're going to the West Coast and there's no contacts there. So we're going to be out of cell phone range for about 6 to 8 weeks, which is pretty exciting. It's always fun.
So even if videos can't be put up for folks, it doesn't mean you can't be out of range of your parents, does it?
That's right. If some sort of emergency or accident happens, then it's good to have the phone just in case. So we did once accidentally, our EPIRB went off, and it was good that we had the sat phone because emergency services contacted us through the sat phone and we could let them know that it was just an accident and that we'd switched it off and that there was no need for a plane to come and save us, because they'd actually deployed a plane our way, which was pretty amazing. But good that we had the sat phone. The Iridium Go is a unit like this, and I'll turn it on now just to test to see if it's working.
It might be low on battery. We haven't charged it for a long time.
No, I've been charging it all day to test it.
What do I know?
So we aren't sponsored or supported, and we don't really endorse this unit, but it's what we've got because when we first bought it, we thought we'd be able to get weather skeds with it. But it turns out that to get weather skeds, it's quite an expensive package and we don't really need it because, as you would have seen us, we get weather through the HF receipt for an HF radio receiver. Is that right? That little Sangian radio?
Yep. That's right. Little shortwave radio.
Yeah. So that's just turned out to be cheap, free and easy for us to get weather. So we haven't really needed this Iridium Go for weather.
So every now and then when we need it, we have had a reasonable deal.
Yeah, so at the moment we're on a $60 a month deal, and I think we've got enough text that we never use it all up, and we've got enough minutes that we never use it all up. I think you get 30 minutes of chat, but we've only got it for emergencies, so we're not going to call anyone unless we absolutely have to. So $60 a month is not that bad to have satellite communications, really.
Yeah, mate, Rob's still helping us out.
Yeah, Rob Martin from ClientSAT, Rob Martin. Put his link in the description, so if you need any help with your sat phone needs, he's really, really great and really useful. We actually got in touch with Rob after we'd bought this Iridium Go unit, so yeah, he's helped us out and found the best option for us, the cheapest option for us to have sat phone communications while we're in the wilds.
The next day we motored to Recherche Bay to wait for the right weather conditions to head to the West Coast.
We just spent a couple of days in Recherche Bay just waiting for the right weather window so that we could scoot over to the amazing Port Davey. So I'm pretty excited and we're feeling the cold.
Feeling the cold is right. I mean, we've just had 2 days as a low went, like a low formed and then took off, and we're going out on the tail end of that. So that low's just brought wind and rain for 2 days, but it dropped the bottom out of the air temperature. So people often ask us about, you know, what's going on with these. And of course it's sun protection most of the time, but at the moment I'm just trying to warm up my normally tropical living cheeks. Because it's about 13 or 14 degrees, but of course I've got a bit of a breeze coming on as well. So
yeah.
I'm getting just a slight bit of wind chill. I spent yesterday patching up these musto pants. I can't really say I'm going to ever buy musto again. They didn't really last that long, and their customer support was pretty crappy. But for the time being, you know, like I've re-glued up all the seams, and we'll make them sort of last. But for such a big name wet weather gear, you know, I was really disappointed in their customer service. Bit of a bummer. You pay all that money and you hope to get something a bit better. Well, as an example of what I meant, like, and we'll just do a little flashback. Here's you know, my Musto jacket. We sent this back to Musto with an email, basically explaining what the situation was. And Musto Australia, and I can't say it for Musto International, but certainly the sales reps in Australia basically told me that
my jacket was falling apart, not because of their fault, but it was actually, I had to take my complaint to the Gore-Tex manufacturer, which I don't know who that is, because I just looked and saw Musto on the thing and just thought the buck stopped there, but apparently it didn't. So yeah, I'll never spend another single cent with that company.
It's very calm right now. It's been quite calm all day, but there's just enough wind for us to sail out, and there's quite big swells. As soon as we tack, we'll put our old trusty lure, Betsy, the hard-bodied Halco Laser Pro, out, and we'll see if we get a tuna.
Missed it all.
That's alright, might have to tack back. I might have been preemptive.
Are you going to make it?
Nah. We'd make it, but we've just got to pinch up for so long that we'll just never make any boat speed. We may as well just
open up.
Just sail her loose, sail a few more miles and sail her faster.
That was pretty much the last of our wind, and as the sun set, we reluctantly turned the motor on until we got some more wind when we rounded Matsaika Island in the early hours of the morning. Just before sunrise, we were motoring again, and I awoke to Troy at the helm, steering us in to our new anchorage at Bond Bay in Port Davey. We were both very relieved to have finally made it. We really hope you enjoyed sailing with us to Port Davey on the west coast of Tasmania this week. If you did, please hit the like button, as it really helps get our video out to a broader audience.
So we moved the boat this morning and we're going up the Davey River.
We look forward to joining you next week as we start exploring this remote Tasmanian wilderness. Bye for now.